to today's video lecture, and in today's video lecture I'll be solving previous year's NEET questions and discussing the answers. And this is for the chapter, as you can see on your screen, neural control and coordination, and this is part 2 of the series. Okay, so let's begin. Okay, so question number 1. Alzheimer's disease in humans is associated with the deficiency of, and this appeared in the year 2000. Okay, so let's go through our options. A, glutamic acid. B, acetylcholine. C, gamma aminobutyric acid, that's GABA. And D, dopamine. Okay, so the right answer is B, acetylcholine. Okay, so if you got B, you've got the right answer. Let's go to the discussion. Okay, so Alzheimer's disease is the common cause of dementia in elderly. Okay, please remember that. Okay, Alzheimer's disease is the common cause of dementia in elderly. Now, what is dementia? Dementia is the loss of previously acquired intelligence. Okay, it's the loss of previously acquired intelligence. Now, let's look at some of the clinical features of Alzheimer's. There's amnesic type of memory impairment. There's deterioration of language. There's visuospatial deficits. So these are the three clinical features of Alzheimer's, just to help you understand what Alzheimer's really is. Okay, now what happens in Alzheimer's? So in the brain, beta amyloid plaques are formed. Okay, beta amyloid plaques are formed where? In the hippocampus, temporal cortex, nucleus basalis minute, and locus coeruleus. Now, these are parts of the brain. This is just to help you understand what Alzheimer's is. Okay, so maybe not for NEET, you won't really need it much for NEET. You just need to associate Alzheimer's with acetylcholine according to the question. But what actually happens is beta amyloid plaques are formed in these parts of the brain. Okay, and what happens when plaques are formed? This results in the disruption of cholinergic and norepinephrine nerves. Okay, so cholinergic nerves are nerves that produce acetylcholine. Okay, so cholinergic and norepinephrine nerves are disrupted. Formation of these nerves are disrupted because of the beta amyloid plaques. Okay, in these parts of the brain. So obviously, yes, the formation will be decreased. Okay, so this is what Alzheimer's is about. Can go back and look at the question. So Alzheimer's disease in humans associated with the deficiency of acetylcholine. Clearly, there's no norepinephrine. If they ever ask norepinephrine, you know norepinephrine is also one of the factors. Okay. All right, clear. I answered the question. Remember, beta amyloid plaques are formed and that disrupts the formation of cholinergic and norepinephrine. Okay, neurotransmitters. It destroys, it damages those nerves. Okay, hence their formation will be decreased. Okay, clear? Let's move on then. Okay, question number 2. During the propagation of a nerve impulse, the action potential results from the movement of, okay, this appeared in the year 2008. So you have 4 options. A, potassium ions from intracellular fluid to extracellular fluid. B, sodium ions from extracellular fluid to intracellular fluid. C, potassium ions from extracellular fluid to intracellular fluid. And D, sodium ions from intracellular fluid to extracellular fluid. So during the propagation of a nerve impulse, the action potential results from the movement of sodium ions from extracellular to intracellular fluid. Okay, this is a very basic concept that you should know. Okay, when a nerve impulse is being passed on through the nerve fiber. So your answer is B. Okay, let's go through the discussion. Okay, so action potential is generated when there's inflow of sodium ions from extracellular fluid to intracellular fluid. Okay. After the impulse has passed the threshold stimulus, an action potential is generated, which results in the rapid opening of sodium ions, leading to influx of ions. Okay, so let's Yeah, so here we have a diagram of a action potential graph. Okay, this is an action potential graph. So you have your resting membrane, then depolarization. Depolarization happens and then followed by repolarization. Okay, so now let's understand one thing, that at the axon hillock, always whenever an impulse is given at the axon hillock, enough stimulus should be provided there for the stimulus to move forward, for the impulse to move forward. There should be enough stimulus at the axon hillock. Now what happens, just an example, if there is enough stimulus at the axon hillock, there are sodium channels that open, small amount of sodium channels that begin to open. So what happens when sodium voltage gated ion channels begin to open, it brings the voltage up towards the positive region. Okay, it's at minus 90, right, at resting. It brings the voltage up towards the positive, right? So as one few voltage gated channels open, sodium ion voltage gated channels open, they provoke other voltage gated channels to also open, the sodium ones. Okay, so if two voltage gated channels are open here, they will provoke two more to open, a few more, let's say. Okay, I'm just giving you a random number. Then they will again provoke a few more to open. Okay, it's like a positive feedback. Some open, then they will provoke the others to open, and another few more sodium channels to open. So what happens? Slowly sodium is moving in, right? So what happens? Then the inner side of the nerve fiber is becoming positive, right? So obviously the potential will move out up towards the positive region. Now there is a limit called threshold stimulus. Okay, it's at minus 65 millivolts. Now once the potential reaches at minus 65 millivolts, there'll be a shoot up. Okay, shoot up means most of the sodium channels will quickly open. They'll quickly open at the same moment, and sodium will move in at a very rapid speed. Here it is happening only slowly. Okay, slowly sodium channels are opening. They're allowing other sodium channels to open, other sodium channels, provided there's enough impulse given at the axon hillock. Okay, once there is enough impulse, few sodium channels open, another few provokes other sodium channels to open, and so slowly sodium is moving in, bringing up the voltage slowly towards the positive region, right? Obviously. And once it reaches minus 65, then there will be a shoot up. Okay, it will be a shoot. Usually it goes up to zero, but there are some large nerve fibers where it will even go up to positive plus 35. Okay, this is what it's trying to tell you in this graph. Okay, that there are some large nerve fibers where there'll be so much influx of sodium ions that will go up to plus 35. There'll be an overshoot over here. Okay, and you see how quickly it happens. Okay, this is zero here. This is 0.1. Already there is a peak. Okay, already there is a peak. It has happened so quickly. Okay, it has happened so quickly. And so this shoot up allows sodium ions to enter the nerve fiber, making it positive. Okay, so this is what action potential generated when the voltage has crossed the threshold stimulus. Okay, and how that happens, I've already explained that to you. But to answer your question, we need to answer the question. During the propagation of a nerve impulse, the action potential results from the movement of sodium ions from extracellular fluid to intracellular fluid. I've already explained that. Okay, this is a very direct question, easy. But provided you understand the concept of nerve impulse, propagation of nerve impulse in the nerve fiber. Okay, so let's move on. Alright, question number 3. During the transmission of nerve impulse through a nerve fiber, the potential on the inner side of the plasma membrane has which type of electric charge? Okay, this appeared in 2007. So let's go through our options. A, first positive, then negative and continue to be negative. First negative, then positive and continue to be positive. First positive, then negative and then again back to positive. D, first negative, then positive and again back to negative. So your answer should be D. Okay, your correct answer should be D. Let's go to the discussion and understand this better. So during resting membrane potential, okay, the inside part of the nerve fiber is more negative than outside, right? You know that a minus 90 millivolt is maintained at resting membrane potential. It makes the inner side of the nerve fiber more negative than outside. Okay. And I've already explained this in the previous video also, where I have spoken about leak channels and sodium potassium pump and how they maintain that minus 90 millivolts. So you can go check that out. So when action potential is generated, the inner part of the nerve fiber becomes positive due to influx of sodium ions. I've already explained how sodium ions or positive feedback cycle is maintained there. A few sodium channels open, they provoke other sodium channels to open, and slowly slowly the voltage goes up towards the positive region. So the inner side of the fiber tends to now become more positive. Okay. And so once it crosses the threshold stimulus, that's minus 65 millivolts, there'll be a shoot up. Okay. Lots of sodium channels will open and there'll be an influx of sodium ions into the nerve fiber. So that makes it positive. Now, once it has passed, as slowly slowly sodium channels begin to close. Okay, once it has crossed that limit. Okay, so slowly slowly sodium channels begin to close, and what happens? Potassium channels begin to open. So there'll be an efflux of potassium ions from inside to outside. Okay, that's called repolarization. Okay, that's called repolarization. So what happens is voltage gated potassium ion channels open, allowing for efflux of potassium ions from the inside to the outside, making the insides more negative than outside. Okay, so first it's negative first, then becomes positive, and then again back to negative. Okay, it has to come back down to the resting membrane potential. Okay, so it's designed, this whole process or the whole system is designed in such a way that it comes back to the resting membrane potential. Okay, clear? So to answer your question, it's question number 3. Yeah, so first it's negative during the transmission of a nerve impulse. First it's at the resting membrane potential, so it's negative, then it becomes positive, and then again back to negative. Okay, so the answer is D. Okay, clear? Again, this was a test on how well you know nerve impulse propagation. So again, this is a very, very important topic. Okay. Okay, of course, this happens due to voltage gated ion channels. Now you are very well aware of that. Okay, so question number 4. Which one of the following does not act as a neurotransmitter? This appeared in 2006. So you have A, cortisone, B, acetylcholine, C, epinephrine, and D, norepinephrine. So we need to find out that does not act as a neurotransmitter. Clearly, if you are aware and if you read the chapter properly, A is the right answer. Cortisone does not act as a neurotransmitter. The other three act as a neurotransmitter. So the answer is A. So cortisone does not act as a neurotransmitter. It is a steroid hormone. Whereas acetylcholine, epinephrine, norepinephrine are neurotransmitters. Okay, clear? This was pretty direct. Okay, you should be well aware of the terms and what neurotransmitters are, what are the different kinds of neurotransmitters. You have to be well prepared for that. Okay, let's move on to the next question then. Okay, so question number 5. Parkinson's disease, characterized by tremors and progressive rigidity of limbs, it's caused by degeneration of brain neurons that are involved in movement control and make use of neurotransmitter. So this appeared in 2005. So it's caused by degeneration of brain neurons that are involved in movement control and make use of neurotransmitter. It is C, dopamine. Okay, it is C, dopamine. If you knew this answer, that means you know Parkinson's disease well. Okay, let's go to the discussion so you can study further. So Parkinson's disease is also known as paralysis agitans. Okay, this is another name for Parkinson's disease. And what happens in Parkinson's disease? It is the destruction of substantia nigra. Okay, so substantia nigra is a part of the brain. It is a part of the midbrain, and it is a dopaminergic nucleus. Okay, so destruction of that substantia nigra, okay, is what happens in Parkinson's disease. And that is that part of the brain usually sends dopamine secreting fibers to caudate nucleus and putamen. Don't worry about the names for NEET, just to help you understand what exactly happens in Parkinson's disease. Hopefully this will help you remember for the exam, okay, or in the future also when you are in medical college, but just to help you understand better. Okay, you just, you know, just remembering dopamine, it's okay, you can learn it as a fact, but what exactly happens is to help you understand that. So this destruction of substantia nigra, okay, and that part of the brain usually sends dopamine secreting fibers to caudate nucleus and putamen. So dopamine is an inhibitory neurotransmitter, okay, hence its absence results in the continuous excitation of of corticospinal motor control system. Okay, now what happens is dopamine, obviously dopamine is an inhibitory, so it stops the motor control system. Okay, just imagine if dopamine was not there. Okay, so then there'll be over excitation, there'll be continuous excitation of muscle, there's nothing there to stop that excitation, okay, the stimulation of those muscles. So the over excitation leads to excitation of many muscles in the body, and hence it results in rigidity. Just imagine if your muscles are continuously being stimulated, okay, so the muscles tend to become rigid. All right, now it is characterized by rigidity of much of the musculature, involuntary tremors even when the person is at resting state, difficulty in initiating movement, that's akinesia, postural inability leading to poor balance, and other motor symptoms like dysphagia. Dysphagia is inability to swallow, the speech disorders, gait disturbances, and fatigue. Okay, so it is characterized by these factors here. To answer your question, yes, dopamine is an inhibitory neurotransmitter, and the substantia nigra, that midbrain, which is present in the midbrain, is destroyed. Okay, they are the ones that send dopaminergic signals to caudate nucleus and putamen. Okay, so that is what leads to tremors and rigidity of muscles. If we go back to the question, yeah, degeneration of brain neurons that are involved in the movement control make use of neurotransmitter dopamine. Clearly, this answers our question, okay, from the discussion. If you want, you can note it down to understand Parkinson's disease better, okay, so it'll help you remember. All right, let's move on then. Okay, so question number 6. In the resting state of the neural membrane, diffusion due to concentration gradients, if allowed, would drive. This appeared in 2004. So we're talking about resting state of the neural membrane, okay? Diffusion due to concentration gradients, if allowed, would drive A, potassium into the cell, B, potassium and sodium out of the cell, sodium into the cell, sodium out of the cell. So clearly from this, the appropriate answer would be C, sodium into the cell. Answer is C. Let's go to the discussion. So in resting membrane, there are more potassium ions inside the nerve fiber and more sodium ions outside the nerve fiber. We already discussed this before, okay? Now, due to, obviously, there'll be a difference in the concentration gradient, okay, inside and outside for the two ions. Now, due to difference in the concentration gradient, there are leak channels, okay, that allow the efflux of these ions to the outside nerve fibers, and sodium ions leak into the nerve fibers through the leak channels. Usually it is more permeable to potassium ions at the resting membrane potential, okay, almost 100 times more permeable. If you go back to my part one of my video, I've already explained this. There are some leak channels present there, a potassium ion leak channels, as well as sodium potassium ATP pump, which helps maintain the minus 90 millivolts. Okay, so it is more permeable to potassium ions, so potassium leaks out, okay, but that doesn't mean sodium does not move in. Yes, some sodium ions are also moving into the nerve fiber. All right, so here's a diagram. So this is a potassium leak channel. So you see potassium is moving out. There is no line for sodium, but there is some sodium ions moving in. okay, some sodium ions are also moving in, okay, due to difference in the concentration gradient. So if you go back to our question, so question says difference due to concentration, if allowed, would drive. Now the appropriate answer is sodium into the cell. Okay, there is no the appropriate answer for this. So answer is C. If you knew this answer, very good for you. You deserve a smiley face because this is a little tricky. You need to understand resting membrane potential, how the resting nerve is maintained. Okay, how the potential of the resting nerve is maintained. All right, clear. Let's move on. Okay, question number 7. What used to be described as Nissl's granules in a nerve cell are now identified as? This appeared in 2003. So you have A, cell metabolites, B, fat granules, C, ribosomes, and D, mitochondria. Clearly it is C, ribosomes. Okay, I've already discussed this in part 1 also. This is like a repeat. So the answer is C. Let's go to the discussion. So Nissl substances is a granular material that stains with basic dissolves, which is also called Nissl bodies or granules. Now these bodies are composed of rough surfaced endoplasmic reticulum that contain ribosomes. Okay, rough surfaced endoplasmic reticulum means there are ribosomes present on the endoplasmic reticulum. Now the presence of these ribosomes is very important because they participate in protein synthesis. Okay, so high level of protein synthesis takes place. Okay, they're needed for maintenance and repair, for production of neurotransmitters as well as enzymes. Sorry. So here's a diagram, okay, of where the Nissl substances are located in the cell body. We notice that in the axon there are no Nissl substances. Okay, this could be a potential MCQ. Okay, so I'm telling you now, in the axon there are no Nissl substances. They'll only be present over here in the cell body, in the dendrites, you know, they'll be spread out over there, but there'll be no Nissl granules in the axon. Okay, clear? This was clear. It was very direct, okay, because I've already discussed this in part 1 also. You should be familiar with Nissl granules. Alright, so we'll move on to the next. Okay, question number 8. Which of the following statement is correct for node of Ranvier of nerve? This appeared in the year 2002. Okay, so we have to find the correct statement. So you have A, neurilemma, which is discontinuous, B, myelin sheath is discontinuous, C, both neurilemma and myelin sheath are discontinuous, D, covered by myelin sheath. So what is correct? Yes, myelin sheath is discontinuous. Okay, well, as neurilemma is continuous, please don't get confused. Okay, we will come to the discussion in some time. So correct answer is B. Okay, let's go to the discussion. So in node of Ranvier, myelin sheath is discontinuous and neurilemma is continuous. Neurilemma is that plasma membrane that is formed on the by the Schwann cell, which, and beneath the neurilemma contains the nucleus and the cytoplasm. Okay, so the neurilemma sheath surrounds the myelin sheath and represents the basal lamina or plasma membrane. Now beneath the membrane lies the Schwann cell nucleus and a thin layer of cytoplasm. Okay, like I said, I've already discussed how the myelin sheath is formed in my previous lecture, part 1. There's a very beautiful diagram of how the myelin sheath forms, you know, circular folds, okay, around the axon membrane. So it's a very, very good topic. So you go back and read that. You can study that through my lecture in part 1. Okay, now what happens is those sheaths, the neurilemma sheaths, they interdigitate. Okay, they interdigitate. I mean, they block. Okay, they interlock themselves together. Okay, at the nodes of Ranvier. And then why is that? Why? Because it is, and it is necessary for regeneration of damaged nerves. That is why those neurilemma sheaths are present there at the node of Ranvier. So one Schwann cells form myelin sheath around one part of the axon, right? Another Schwann cell will form the myelin sheath around the next part of the axon. So obviously, there are like two different Schwann cells, okay? They're two different nucleus, two different cytoplasm. But the neurilemma, the plasma membrane, the basal lamina, they interdigitate, okay? At the node of Ranvier. I have a diagram for that to help you understand. Yeah. So you see, the myelin sheath is not continuous. You have the node of Ranvier over here. myelin sheath is not continuous, the black portion here, but this neuralemmel sheath. Now this part of the axon, one Schwann cell has formed the myelin sheath. This part of the axon, another Schwann cell has formed the myelin sheath. But myelin sheath obviously is not continuous, but the neuralemmel is interdigitating. Well, that's what's happening over here. Okay, they are interlocking with each other. Why is that? Because it's necessary for regeneration of damaged nerve. Okay, so this is what's happening here. So please don't confuse yourself. Don't assume that just because myelin sheath is not continuous, neuralemmel sheath is also not continuous. That is incorrect. Neuralemmel sheath is continuous. Okay, they are continuous even they are present in the node of Ranvier. Okay, myelin sheath is not present there. Okay, so please remember that fact. Okay, this is very important. If you knew this, again, you deserve a smiley face. Okay, so that means you know your anatomy and histology very well. All right, so if you go back to our question, yeah, it's correct for node of Ranvier. Yeah, myelin sheath is discontinuous. Okay, there is, I guess I've cleared your doubt for those of you who had a doubt about this. We'll move on to the next question. Okay, question number 9. Depolarization of axolemma during nerve conduction takes place because of, this appeared in the year 2000. Okay, let's go through our options. A, equal amount of sodium potassium move out across axolemma. B, sodium move inside and potassium move more outside. C, more sodium outside. D, none of these. Okay, so depolarization of axolemma. Now, so we know the sodium moves inside. Okay, during depolarization, or potassium move more outside, that doesn't make sense. Okay, there's no equal amount of sodium and potassium, obviously. So the appropriate answer to this question would be D. Okay, based on the options that are given to us, it is actually none of these. Okay, we'll go to the discussion now. Oh, okay, so you have a graph here. During depolarization, action potential is generated after the impulse has crossed the threshold stimulus. We are already aware of that, no doubt about it, right? Sodium channels begin to open, they provoke other sodium channels to open like a positive feedback cycle till it reaches the towards the positive. Okay, then there will be a threshold stimulus, it will cross the threshold stimulus and shoot up. Okay, it will shoot up like this, okay, towards the positive region. Okay, so let's say this is your membrane potential, say minus 6, minus 65 over here. Let's say this was around the threshold stimulus. Let me choose another diagram. Okay, and then it will shoot up. Okay, overshoot happens in the case of some large nerve fibers. There's too many sodium channels and they open too many and then they make the whole nerve fiber inside very positive. So it becomes, you know, positive. It goes towards the positive region above zero. Don't worry about that. It's fine. Okay. So it has crossed the threshold stimulus and it has gone up. Okay. So this results in the rapid opening of voltage gated sodium ion channels. Obviously, I've already explained threshold stimulus has crossed, sodium gated, sodium voltage gated ion channels open, okay, leading to influx of these ions into the nerve fiber. Now, after depolarization has occurred, okay, to restore the negative potential difference, now within a few 10,000ths of a second, sodium ion channels begin to close. Very quickly as sodium ion channels open, they also begin to close, okay, within 10,000. Let's say it has reached here. I am drawing a line down here. This is actually a very good graph. If you are interested, I mean, don't go through this because of NEET or anything. I've taken this from Guyton, just for your information. Guyton is the author. He has written a book on textbook of medical physiology. It's a very book, a good book to study human physiology. But you'll come across this in MBBS. Don't study this for NEET. So, and they have done this through experimentation. Okay, this is not just observation or whatever. They have conducted experiments in the lab and they've come to this conclusion. So, what happens is, as quickly as you can see this red line here, as quickly as sodium voltage gated channels open, they also begin to close. Okay, this is quite quick. You can look at the time also over here within milliseconds. Now, when depolarization is happening, potassium ion channels have opened during depolarization. Okay, but you can see it is very slow. You can see over here, it is very slow. Sodium ion channels have opened, they have done their job, they have within few 10,000ths of a second, sodium ion channels begin to close. Okay, and voltage gated potassium ion channels opened, leading to efflux of potassium ions to the outside of the nerve fiber. That's the theory. Okay, so see, once this overshoot has happened or it has reached its peak, you can see that potassium ion channels have already started to open, but they are very slow, okay, as compared to sodium ion channels. Okay, potassium ion channels are very voltage gated potassium ion channels are very slow. So during depolarization, some few potassium ion channels have opened or are opening at that point, okay, but not much is happening. Little bit of potassium ions are moving out of the nerve fiber, few, till it reaches at this point, okay. Till it reaches at this point, slowly, after this depolarization has been completed, then slowly, potassium ion channels begin to open. Okay, so they take a lot more time. That's why first quickly sodium ion channels open. During that time, potassium ion channels are opening, but it is very slow. It is not as fast as sodium ion channels. Potassium ion channels don't work as quick as sodium ion channels. Okay. So they are opening during depolarization, but most of the job that potassium ions are doing is during repolarization, that is when this graph is going down. Okay, when this graph is going down, okay, that is when repolarization happens. Okay, when repolarization happens, potassium ion channels have opened, quite a number of potassium ion channels by then have opened. So their process is very slow as compared to sodium ions. So what happens is potassium ions are moving at a very slow rate. Okay, even during depolarization, let's say it is not like 100% potassium ion channels don't open, they are beginning to open, but at a very, very slow rate. Okay, where only few potassium ions are moving out. Okay, don't, in nature, nothing is absolute, nothing is 100%. If sodium ion channels are open, potassium ion channels will never open. It doesn't work that way, right? A human body is a very dynamic state. It's not a very absolute state, where there's no zero or one. Okay, we are fluctuating between that. So once sodium ion channels are open, potassium ion channels are open very slow for you to understand, and a small amount of efflux of potassium ions are happening from inside to outside. Okay, and so this then eventually leads to, by the time sodium ion channels have closed and potassium ion channels have started functioning, maybe more and more and more potassium ion channels begin to open, and there, so there's an efflux of potassium ions. Okay, if we and hence for this results in repolarization, then bringing the whole nerve fiber back to the resting membrane potential. Okay, so if we go back to our question, you could have a doubt in option B, but option B is incorrect. Oh, potassium move more outside is wrong, because potassium ion channels during depolarization do open, but at a very, very, very slow rate. Is a very slow movement of potassium ions as compared to sodium ions. So therefore, the answer should be none of these. Please, I am sure you have come across this question at a number of places on the internet where they've given you all weird answers. Please don't follow that. Okay, this is what it is. Okay, this is what's actually happening, and this is taken from a proper medical textbook. All right, so this was a good question. So if you were able to answer this, that means you know your nerve impulse very, very well, very properly. You understood it from the inside. And now any kind of question that you get, you would be able to answer it very clearly without any doubt. Okay? Clear? I hope I was clear for this. All right? So let's move on. Okay, question number 10. The junction between the axon of one neuron and the dendrite of the next is called, disappeared in the year 1999. So you have A, constant bridge, B, junction point, C, a joint, D, a synapse. So the junction between the axon of one neuron and the dendrite of the next is called a synapse. Clear? This was again a very direct question. should know this answer very well. There should be no doubt about it. So synapse, this is taken from NCERT's definition. A synapse is formed by the membranes of a presynaptic neuron and a postsynaptic neuron, which may or may not be separated by a gap called synaptic cleft. Okay, so this definition of synapse is given in NCERT. Please read NCERT very carefully. This diagram is also taken from there, from NCERT. So you know what entails a synapse. You have presynaptic membrane, you have a synaptic cleft, and you have a postsynaptic membrane. Okay, clear? This was a very direct question. We'll move on then to the next one. Okay, question number 11. Which of the following is regarded as a unit of nervous tissue? This appeared in the year 1999. So, you have A, neurons, B, myelin sheath, C, axons, and D, dendrites. So, regarded as a unit of nervous tissue, clearly it is A, neurons. Clear? Unit of nervous tissue, obviously neurons. Propagation of impulse is taking place, receives impulse, propagation of impulse also takes place. So, neurons are regarded as a unit of nervous tissue. Alright, clear? We move on to the next question. Okay, question number 12. The Nissl's granules of nerve cells are made up of... Okay, again, Nissl granules question. This appeared in 1997. A, DNA, B, RNA, C, ribosome, D, protein. Okay, so you have ribosomes. We've already discussed this. The answer is C. Okay, protein synthesis takes place. I'll not go through this again because it's the same answer. It's made out, the bodies are composed of rough surface endoplasmic reticulum that contain ribosomes, and of course protein synthesis takes place. Okay, please remember this function. I'll not waste more time on this. Okay, we'll move on to the next question. I've already discussed this. Okay, which part of the brain is responsible for thermoregulation? It's a very neat 2019, quite recent. You have A, medulla oblongata, B, cerebrum, C, hypothalamus, and D, corpus callosum. So thermoregulation is maintained by C, hypothalamus, okay, in the brain. The answer is C. Let's go to the discussion. So hypothalamus is responsible for thermoregulation. Okay, now how that happens is, now there's a preoptic area of the anterior hypothalamus. Okay, this is the region where thermoregulation is controlled by the hypothalamus, the preoptic area of anterior hypothalamus. This could be a potential MCQ. That's why I'm giving you this information. So please remember this. You can note it down in your book. The preoptic area of the anterior hypothalamus, okay, is responsible for thermoregulation. Now how that happens? There are a large number of heat sensitive neurons and about one third of cold sensitive neurons, okay, in that area. The heat sensitive neurons and the one third of cold sensitive neurons also in that area. And these neurons are known to function as temperature sensitive neurons. So now what happens when the preoptic area is heated? When the preoptic area is heated, okay, when the blood passes by and the temperature is high, okay, so they have heat sensitive neurons there, right? So even the skin automatically breaks into sweat. You begin to sweat, okay, and blood vessels dilate, okay, and any excess body heat production is inhibited. So you sweat, your blood vessels dilate, and any excess heat production is inhibited, okay, it stops producing heat. It has to remove all the excess heat from your body, okay, that's why you begin to sweat and your blood vessels dilate during that time, okay. So because there are temperature sensitive neurons that are present in the preoptic area of anterior hypothalamus. Alright, so this is how thermoregulation takes place. So your hypothalamus has to maintain a temperature in the body. Okay, it has to maintain, which is at 37 degrees. Okay, it has to maintain that temperature in the body. So if your body has become too hot or it's too cold, it will adjust the temperature accordingly. Okay, so we already seen that when there are, when the preoptic area is heated, you begin to start sweating. Alright, so this is how thermoregulation happens. Now, thermoregulation is only one of the functions of hypothalamus, right? There are other functions also of the hypothalamus. We will go through this. You will also come across this as and when you study human physiology in your, for your NEET exam. Okay, so I thought I'll give you you know, a brief on what are the other functions of hypothalamus also. Okay, so the other functions of hypothalamus are the cardiovascular regulation. So what happens, the posterior and the lateral hypothalamus increases the arterial pressure and heart rate. The preoptic area decreases arterial pressure and heart rate. Okay, and this stimulation is sent from the cardiovascular regions in pons and medulla. So cardiovascular region, the pons and medulla, stimulate the posterior and lateral hypothalamus to increase the pressure, arterial pressure and heart rate, and the preoptic area to decrease the pressure, arterial pressure and heart rate. Okay, this is one of the functions. Second is regulation of body water. So it has a thirst center there. Okay, it creates a sensation of thirst. So you feel thirsty, you begin to look for water and drink water. That's one of the function. The other is it controls the excretion of water in urine. How? By controlling the secretion of ADH from posterior pituitary gland. Okay, so it sends a signal to the posterior pituitary gland to secrete ADH as antidiuretic hormone. You are very familiar with ADH, I'm sure. Go back to excretory system, read the chapter, and I've also explained the functions of ADH over there. Okay, so by secreting ADH, it is able to control. How? That it controls the nerve fibers in the supraoptic nuclei of hypothalamus become stimulated when there's an increase in concentration of electrolytes. Okay, so it begins, the supraoptic nuclei of the hypothalamus gets stimulated when there's an increase in the concentration of electrolytes. Okay, so this is how it regulates body water. Okay, that's another function of hypothalamus. Okay, we also come across ADH when you study the hormone system, the chemical coordination integration chapter. There also ADH has been mentioned, plus excretory system also has a topic on ADH. So please go and study that. The other function is regulation of uterine contraction and milk ejection from breasts. Okay, so stimulation of the paraventricular nuclei results in the release of oxytocin, which increases stimulation of uterus, that is during childbirth. Okay, so it also stimulates the myoepithelial cells surrounding the alveoli to secrete the milk through the nipples from the breasts. You will come across this again in reproduction system. When you study reproduction system, you study parturition, you will come across this. Okay, so hypothalamus plays a role over there also. Gastrointestinal and feeding regulation. Okay, so the center that causes desire for hunger is located in the lateral hypothalamic area. So when you feel hungry, the hunger center is also present there in the lateral hypothalamic area. And so when an animal is hungry, they go around searching for food. Okay, they start procuring food. That's one of the functions. The ventromedial nuclei contains a satiety center. That means when you feel full, when you've eaten enough, you have a feeling in your mind, your brain, that tells you, you know, stop, I can't eat anymore. And even if food is kept in front of you, you feel indifferent to it. You don't want to eat it. So that's satiety, that you've reached your limit. Okay, so that is also present in the hypothalamus. Endocrine hormone secretion. So various hypothalamic nuclei release stimulating and inhibitory hormones. And so what that does is the blood supply to the anterior pituitary supply by the lower part of hypothalamus, which controls the release of anterior pituitary gland hormones. Okay, so there are stimulatory and inhibitory hormones that stimulate the anterior pituitary gland to secrete endocrine hormones. Again, you will study this in chemical coordination and integration in much detail. So I'm not going through this in detail now. Okay, so but I wanted you to give you an overview of what hypothalamus does and how important that organ is. Okay, of the brain, a very important part of the brain. So this is it. These are the functions of hypothalamus. To answer your question was quite simple. Thermoregulation, that's one of the functions. We'll go back to the question. Which part of the brain is responsible for thermoregulation? Hypothalamus. Clearly. Yeah, there was no doubt about this. So, but apart from that, if they ask you any other function, you know what to say. Let's move on to the next question. Okay, so question number 14. Which of the following structures or regions is incorrectly paired with its functions? Okay, and this appeared in the year 2018. So you have A, medulla oblongata, controls respiration, cardiovascular reflexes. B, limbic system, consists of fiber tracts that interconnect different regions of brain, controls movement. C. Hypothalamus production of releasing hormones and regulation of temperature, hunger, and thirst. D. Corpus callosum, band of fibers connecting left and right cerebral hemispheres. So you have to find the incorrect pairing, right? With this function. So clearly, B, limbic system is the incorrect one. Okay? The rest, the B, C, sorry, A, C, and D are correct. So your answer is B. Let's go to the discussion. So the limbic system is also called limbic lobe or limbic region, consists of the following parts. Now, what are the parts of the limbic system? The portions of basal ganglia, anterior nuclei of thalamus, septum area, para olfactory area, amygdala, hippocampus, and finally hypothalamus. Hypothalamus forms a very important part of the limbic system. So this is how the limbic system is arranged in the brain. Okay, so this is just to give you an idea. Don't worry about the words, the orbitofrontal. This is just a design of the brain that's given to you from where it starts and where it ends. Okay, so this is how the limbic system is arranged in the brain. Okay, and these are the parts of the limbic system. All right, let's go through the functions of the limbic system. So some of the functions include integration of olfactory, visceral, and somatic impulses reaching the brain, the control of activities necessary for survival of the animal, such as procuring food. Yeah, we discussed that. Sexual behavior is also a part of that. Emotional behavior, retention of recent memory. I guess, oops, sorry. Yeah, so these are the some of the functions of the limbic system. Okay, so such as emotional behavior is anger or fear. You know, they are controlled by amygdala. Amygdala. Okay, and retention of recent memories. The hippocampus is responsible for that. Okay, retention of recent memory. So these are some of the functions that are responsible. That the limbic system is responsible for. Okay, so to answer your question clearly, that was the incorrect one. I just wanted to give you information on what the limbic system actually is. Okay, and there's obviously more research being conducted in the limbic system. That's why there was a textbook. It said it can be called limbic region and not a limbic system. But okay, that's a different topic. I will not go into that in detail. But yeah, this is clearly the incorrect answer. Okay, so limbic system is not responsible for this. The rest obviously are correct. So B is the right answer for this. Okay, let's move on then. All right, question number 15. Which of the following regions of the brain is incorrectly paired with its functions? This appeared in 2015, so cancelled exam. A. Corpus callosum, communication between the left and right cerebral cortices. B. Cerebrum, calculation and contemplation. C. Medulla oblongata, homeostatic control. And D. Cerebellum, language comprehension. So you find the incorrectly paired. So clearly, D. Cerebellum is the incorrect answer. Cerebellum is not responsible for language comprehension. We'll go through the functions of cerebellum, the discussion. So the functions of cerebellum, they include control of movement, ensuring that movement takes place smoothly in the right direction and to the right extent. Now, what does that mean? The cerebellum is usually considered the silent area of the brain. Why is it called the silent area of the brain? Because when you directly stimulate it, it does not perform any motor control itself. It is not sending out any motor signals on its own. So it's like a silent area of the brain. Now, what it does is when you are performing coordinated activities, you know, like swimming, walking, running, or cycling, or typing, or playing the piano, you know, for these activities, you need a coordinated movement, right? You're moving in order, right? Your muscle activities, your hands, your legs, they're all moving in order. How that is done? The cerebellum controls that, okay? Cerebellum learns those activities, okay? And it controls it. How does it do it? The cerebellum, it receives information of the desired muscle activity, sorry, from the motor control areas of the brain. Okay, so the motor control areas of the brain, it receives signals from there. It also receives signals from the sensory and peripheral nerves, the sensory nerves of the peripheral system. Okay, the muscles of the body. Okay, so it is receiving sensory information, it is receiving motor information from both ends. Okay, it is receiving information from both ends. Now, what the cerebellum does, it compares the two. Okay, now the signal that the motor controller is giving out and the signal that the sensory nerves are giving out. Okay, now what happens is if the signals don't match, okay, they are not favorable, the motor it sends a signal to the motor cortex to either increase or decrease the levels of activation of specific muscles. So it feels that, you know, the motor cortex is not sending enough or the appropriate signal for the sensory to act in an appropriate way. It will send a signal back to the motor cortex to change, to either increase or decrease. So it is doing an adjustment there, right? It is helping you to coordinate that muscle activity, okay, that you are doing. It also helps the cerebral cortex in planning the next move a fraction of a second in advance for its smooth transition to the next movement while the first movement is still going on. Many times, even when you're typing or playing the piano, okay, or playing any musical instrument, anything, you already know in advance what the next move is going to be, okay? So you're that smooth transition, even when still you're doing the first movement, the smooth transition to the second movement is done by the cerebellum. Okay, so this is the first function, this is the second function of the cerebellum. It is able to transition then move, okay, from one movement to the next movement. Thirdly, cerebellum also learns from its mistakes, okay, by exciting some of the cerebral neurons, bringing the subsequent muscle contractions into better correspondence with the intended movement. Okay, so if there's a mistake, it will learn from those mistakes by exciting some of the neurons that are present in the cerebellum. Okay, and so for the subsequent muscle contraction, okay, into better correspondence. So it if a particular function is or a movement is incoordinated, it's not coordinating properly, okay, so it'll learn from that mistake and it'll excite some of the cerebral neurons to bring it back into the normal activity or normal movement. Okay, so these are the three functions of cerebellum. You can note it down, it will be helpful for you for your exam, okay, so that you can learn. To go back to your question, cerebellum, yeah, we clearly doesn't participate in language comprehension. Sorry, so clearly D is the right answer. It's the incorrect pairing here. The others fit perfectly. Okay, question number 16. Injury localized to the hypothalamus would most likely disrupt. This appeared in 2014. A. Short-term memory. B. Coordination during locomotion. C. Executive functions such as decision making. D. Regulation of body temperature. So if the hypothalamus was injured, clearly regulation of body temperature would be affected. So answer is D. We already discussed this. We've already discussed, in fact, in detail what hypothalamus does. So one of the functions of hypothalamus is to regulate body temperature. Hence, its damage would disrupt the regulation of body temperature. I will not go into detail. I've already discussed this in my previous question. Please go back and study that. Okay, so we'll move on to the next question. Okay, question number 17. A sagittal section of human brain is shown here. Identify at least two labels from A to D. Karnataka NEET 2013. So you have A as cerebrum, then you have B over here, which is the hypothalamus or the thalamus rather. This is the thalamus. C is pons veroli and D is cerebellum. So C, okay, here and this fits in A cerebrum, C pons veroli. Okay, the others don't match. So it's clearly B. The answer is B. Okay, let's go to the discussion. A cerebrum, B is thalamus, C is pons veroli, and D is sorry, cerebral. Please study the diagrams from NCERT very, very carefully, okay? This will come in the exam. If you know your diagrams very well, you can just get the right answer. You'll gain a point from that. Okay, that's a very simple way of gaining marks. Alright, then we'll move on to the next question. Question number 18. This appeared in 2012. The human hindbrain comprises three parts, one of which is A. Spinal cord, B. Corpus callosum, C. Cerebellum, and D. Hypothalamus. So the human hindbrain contains cerebellum. Okay, one of the three parts of the human hindbrain, cerebellum. Answer is C. Let's go to the discussion. So human hindbrain consists of pons veroli, medulla oblongata, and of course cerebellum. So this is a diagram that's taken from NCERT. Like I said, again, study the diagram from NCERT. Okay. So you have pons, you have cerebellum, and you have the medulla over here. Clearly, they have said that this is the hindbrain. There's no doubt about it, right? If you knew this very carefully, you would know the answer. Okay, so quite simple question. We'll move on. Okay, so we've come to the end of this video lecture, and I hope you've liked today's video lecture, and I hope you've learned something new today. So please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to MJ Neat Biology, and I'm available on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and you can follow me there for more updates, and I'll see you in the next video lecture. All right, so bye.